I'm Jay Misquick, director of Aliform Publishing, which specializes in Latin American literature and translation and Spanish-English dictionaries. In this series of videos, we're going to take a look at some concepts from analytical philosophy and structural linguistics and see how we can use those terms to help us make decisions as we're translating literary texts. We're going to base our discussion on three books in particular: George Steiner's After Babel, Aspects of Translation and Language, Ferdinand de Saussure's Course in General Linguistics, and Saul Kripke's Naming and Necessity. We're going to take a look at some basic terms such as meaning, definition, connotation, denotation, but we're also going to examine some more complex ideas such as rigid designators, accidental designators, contingency, referentiality, etc., and again use those concepts to think through our decisions as we take a text from one language and put it into another. Before we get to those terms, though, we're going to examine kind of the general process of translation, though it's not really a linear process at all. Probably better said, we're going to look at some aspects and some general considerations to keep in mind as we're doing translating. We're going to look at first the kind of literal first early rough drafts of a translation, then our movement from literal to more figurative and connotative translations, how we address things such as voice and other stylistic aspects, some of the more technical and mechanical things to keep in mind with regarding syntax, punctuation, grammar, etc. Before we move on to Kripke's text, we're also going to take a special look at the idea of voice. That is the idea of what you hear in your head as you're reading the text, and how voice has to do with both the individual text being looked at, the individual narrator within a text, but also how any writing comes out of a community of speakers, a community of collective understanding. After we've looked at some of these overlapping aspects of translation and language, we'll move on to Kripke's text, Naming and Necessity, and in particular, as I mentioned, the idea of rigid designators, accidental designators, to take a look at the ideas of contingency and context and how the particular grouping together of ideas sometimes makes us stray a little bit from the direct literal translation of words and phrases. Let's be clear, I'm not offering any kind of theory of translation. I am not offering any kind of rules of translation, but just some general, practical, pragmatic considerations to take into account as we attempt to translate a literary text. Jacques Derrida said about a potential science of writing, I think what could be said about any potential science of translation. He says about that science of writing, it may never be able to define the unity of its project or its object, or to write its discourse on method, or describe the limits of its field. Steiner says that the body of praxis around translation is so large and differential as to resist inclusion in any unitary scheme. So the best we can do as translators, again to borrow Steiner's words, is to examine the purely empirical principles, devices, routines which have controlled the translator's choice of this equivalent rather than that, of one stylistic level in preference to another, of the choice of word X instead of word Y. Translation is really best when it's self-effacing. That is, the best translations, the reader doesn't notice that they're reading a translated text. We're really aiming to come to a very natural sounding translation, something that sounds as if it were written in that second language into which we are translating. We're trying to present something that's just already there, not to make it necessarily different, but the same, except in a new language. And let's be honest, as much as any creative or intellectual endeavor, translation is a series of grinding tasks. It's looking up words in a dozen different dictionaries. It's re-examining the same word or phrase from a variety of angles. It's checking commas versus semicolons. It's checking for potential references that we may not have noticed on our first reading and are finally getting to on the second or third or fourth text around. And the number of drafts any translation is going to go through is really endless. I would say that of novels I've translated, to do 10 or 12 drafts wouldn't be unusual. A translation is really only finished when the editor tells you, I need that text tomorrow. Otherwise, we can go on indefinitely looking over texts and self-correcting them and modifying them and tuning them up. I have a literary background. I have a master's and PhD in comparative literature from the City University of New York, and was fortunate enough to have as my director of my dissertation one of the great translators ever, Gregory Rabassa. I did my academic studies really in the heyday of structuralism and post-structuralism, in the era of Roland Barthes and Jacques Derrida and Michel Foucault and Alain Cixous. And those structuralists and post-structuralists really helped me come to an understanding of the way language functions, of its underlying structure, of the distant different systems of understanding that it draws upon. As the director of Aliform Publishing, I have translated 9 novels into English from Spanish. I have edited at least that many. I've done a number of translations as well from the French, essays by Foucault, essays by Simone de Beauvoir, musical programs for the Brooklyn Academy of Music. And I, besides the literary work, have done a fair amount of technical translation. I have done texts, the annual report for the Spanish National Railroad. I have done archival work for some of the biggest banks in Colombia, and have also worked with a number of civil and agricultural engineers at the National Polytechnical Institute here in Oaxaca, where I live. Texts that have examined things from developing sustainable forms of concrete for large-scale building projects to efficient methods of irrigations in the semi-arid atmosphere that we live in here in Oaxaca, things about the post-Atlantic reactions that cement goes through when it is exposed to different environments. And so besides the literary elements of translation, I've also been aware of and concerned with really the exactness and the necessity for exactness in translation as well too. Some of the books that I think are important to my understanding of translation and might be of interest to those who are endeavoring to make this part of their career are a couple of the books I've already mentioned, George Steiner's After Babel, The Course in General Linguistics by Saussure, Jacques Derrida's Of Grammatology, Jacques Lacan's Speech and Language and Psychoanalysis, as well as his book, The Four Fundamental Concepts of Psychoanalysis. And one book in particular, Gregory Rabassa's If This Be Treason, Translation and Its Discontents, which, as much as kind of a technical look at translation, is the memoir of the great experiences that Rabassa had translating writers from Latin America and Spain, people like who Julio Cortázar, Gabriel García Márquez, Luisa Valenzuela, Clarice Lispector, and how his kind of personal experiences have made him such a great humanist, and the importance of that humanistic endeavor that the translator takes upon her shoulders to take a work of art and put it into a new form to broaden that audience. In the next video, we're going to take a look at some general aspects of translation. We're going to take a look at those early rough literal texts, then how we can move from the literal to the more poetic or metaphoric translations. We're going to consider the phrase or the sentence as the primary unit of translation, not the word as the primary unit of translation, but the phrase itself. And then we're going to start taking a look at some of the considerations we need to take into account when we think about voice and style. Until then, un saludo cordial de la Sierra Oaxaca.